You know, usually I tell you to get a snack for these, but I think today you might need a whole meal because we have so much to discuss. And that, I think, for all its flaws, is one of Avengers Infinity War's greatest strengths. Why I told you you had to watch out for spoilers being revealed to you. Because it demands, first he demands your silence, and then he demands you gossip the hell out of it. Because there is just so much that needs to be discussed. Even if it's like, I can't believe they did that in a negative way, you want to talk about it. So we're going to have quite the conversation. Yes, welcome to my spoiler review for Avengers Infinity War, which is now officially playing across the globe. And as always, when you get out of the theater, I'm sorry I missed some of you this time, but it was a special situation with the spoilers. But I like to be there waiting for you after you've seen said movie. All right, so in a second, I shall reveal our list of topics that we're going to discuss right now. And I'd like to take this opportunity to remind you that chapter times are down below in the video description if there's something you just can't wait to talk about and you don't like the order that I've chosen. Also, I want to note that my approach to this video is to discuss the movie that we got, because it's so far afield from the one many of us wanted. Like, no Hawkeye? What the heck is with that, right? That's gonna get its own video. So, okay, here we go. Spoiler time, you ready? All right, now, as I noted in my emoji review, a lot of characters died, right? But some only died. So let's talk about the legit deaths first. But even those, I could totally see them being reversed. Oh, by the way, I said I wasn't gonna talk about the movie that we didn't get, but I guess it frustrates me because people are so, they won't let other franchises get away with anything, but yet Marvel doesn't have the guts to kill Cap or Tony or even Thor, one of their three, their trilogies are supposed to be all wrapped up and not even kill them permanently, just for like a movie or even in between the two movies. They can't even do that. And everyone so far is like, it's okay, Marvel, don't worry about it. We still love you. And you're like, I don't know. It's just like, again, as I said in my non-spoiler review, I feel like I'm taking crazy pills. And I'm going to bring that up later with another point. Because I'm sorry, it's just really frustrating. All right. So right out of the gate, they've killed a bunch of Asgardians. Whatever. I knew thee well, that famous line? I don't know any of these people, so whatever. But I did know Idris Elba and Tom Hiddleston, who I think they've reached the end of the line. I also think not only as characters, but I think as actors. I mean, like, think about Idris Elba. What's he ever gotten to do here? I hope he rainbow bridged his soul over to the DCEU. Now, you might be like, why would you go there? Anything would be better than this, and he would be an amazing John Stewart Green Lantern. Oh, please! Also, I have to say, as far as Heimdall's death goes, I couldn't believe they killed a black character first. I don't know why nobody on set was like, are we really gonna do that? Like, again, then they don't get called on it. You know, it's like the most cliche, offensive thing, movies, one of the most cliche, offensive things in genre filmmaking, and Marvel does it, and everyone's like, eh, don't worry about it. I'm like, ugh! All right, so I think Idris Elba, good luck. Go find something better, buddy. More power to you. As for Hiddleston, I do feel bad that he never truly got to be evil because he's so deliciously evil in the comics. But he is a god, right? I think he's coming back, and maybe this will make him more evil. Maybe he'll come back as teenage Loki, one of my favorite runs for the character in the comics. I don't think they got rid of him. I just don't believe it. I don't believe it. But I will say that Tom Hiddleston's acting was amazing. And even though he like died right away, they're like, we're not giving you any runway, Hiddleston. You're gonna have to take off like a helicopter here emotionally. He did. I really felt it. I was like, oh, I knew he was gonna die, but I felt really bad for him, and I believe that he felt bad. And also, I felt that Chris Hemsworth felt bad, despite all the problems they've had. I thought it was handled surprisingly well for, again, something that had no setup, just happened, right? But it didn't happen, it wasn't staged so that there was even shock value, like, oh my God, like, one of my favorite things, like when Gal Gadot's character actually died in the Fast and Furious movies. You were like, what just happened? It didn't even have that because you knew it was happening. And I guess because you don't think it's permanent. Maybe that's, I think that just not believing that Marvel's going to, has the guts to go through with keeping any of these deaths permanent really takes away a lot of the ramifications. So it's all about the style of how they go out. And I think in a lot of cases that was lacking. All right, so let's talk about Gamora. This was hilarious. So in my non-spoiler review, I said a female character gets fridged. And some of you were like, oh, you told me a female character died. And it's like, there's a, well, you know, I can't believe I ranked the Marvel movies and I was making my poster frame for that video. And I was like, oh, I like to try and have diversity, in my poster frames, representation. And I couldn't put a female character in there because they haven't had any movies yet. And I was like, oh. But, there were a lot of candidates, so I didn't feel that was a spoiler. But what was really funny to me is someone wrote me and said, Grace, you told me how a character dies. And I said, I did not do that. And you said, and the person said, yeah, you said they got fridged. Because the person had never heard the term before. I was like, no, nobody got killed by a refrigerator in Infinity War. Don't worry about it. I'm sorry. I'm sorry I wasn't clear enough. So that's why I'm going to briefly explain what fridged is. Because some of you obviously don't know. Now, fridged is something that came from comic books. It literally comes from a storyline where Kyle Rayner, when he was the Green Lantern, when one of his villains, in an effort to get to him, killed his girlfriend when Kyle Rayner wasn't home and stuffed her in the refrigerator and left a note and was like, go look in the fridge. And they actually drew it and had her body parts in there, etc. Back when comics also had more guts, right? But a lot of creators, especially female creators, spoke out about it at the time and said, we're sick and tired of female characters having horrible things done to them purely to move a male character's storyline forward, right? That was the problem. And, comics have worked very hard to correct this. But then Marvel goes and does it in the biggest movie they're supposed to ever put out. And again, nobody says anything, or at least not yet. We'll see. I'm really curious because they're like, and even in this movie, they're like, oh, that's why you're the most dangerous woman in the galaxy, Gamora. And I'm like, I have to keep taking people's word for this because I have yet to see it. I've seen this woman in two movies. Now I've seen her in this Avengers movie, and she hasn't done anything but embarrass herself, which we'll get to in a moment. But so I was kind of annoyed about that. So she never reached her full potential as a character. And then she literally died to further a male character storyline, to give Thanos what he wanted, both to give him the Infinity, the Soul Stone. Her death was what unlocked the Soul Stone. We'll talk about that. I'm trying to do this in some order because there's just so much to talk about. But also to give him an emotional hurdle, right? And so he could have pathos and feel sad, and you could see Thanos cry. And I was like, you're crying? How about poor Gamora? So that was... that was frustrating. And then, as I said, she looked super dumb in her final moments. She was like, ha, ha, ha. I've been waiting for you to get your comeuppance. Karma's a bitch, Thanos. I wish she had said that. At least she could have gone out with a little more style. But she was like, you've wanted stuff your whole life, but now because you don't care about... I was like, keep talking, Gamora. How can you... I think Red Skull, and we're going to talk about him in just a moment, who was the guardian of the Soul Stone, but he should have rolled his eyes and been like, oh my God, how can you not tell it's you? This is so stupid. And I knew it was her as soon as Red Skull appeared, just like this shadowy figure, and Thanos moved to protect Gamora, I was like, wow, he really cares for her. And so as soon as they were like, you got to kill someone you love, he was like, whew, thank goodness I brought this one with me. Right? I think that it was also funny to me because Gamora was like, your luck's run out. And I'm like, what are you talking about? He's so lucky. He could have come here by himself, or he could have brought Nebula, right? But it's you. And you're, of course, the one who has to unlock it. It was crazy. Although I would like to point out that the little Gamora, sometimes I have a problem when they try and make little girls attractive in movies. I think it's a little creepy. You shouldn't think of little girls in that way. But I thought that this actress did a really nice job. She looked very nice, but she still looked very much like a child. And I thought she had, she came across really well. She had a lot of strength of personality, which I thought was really impressive. So I liked little Gamora. Maybe we'll be able to have a flashback with her someday. I don't know. We'll see. All right, now as for the deaths, Thanos snapped his fingers as promised. I'm glad they followed that screenwriting rule. If someone says he's going to snap his fingers, he's got to do it by the end of the movie. And snap his fingers, he did. forget Thor being told to go for Thanos' head. He should have cut off his fingers. All right, so then, of course, all the Avengers, faded away like ash. Not all of them, but mostly all of them, actually, faded away like ash. Basically, Thanos was doing population control. We're going to talk about that with Thanos. But anyway, the biggest gasp when the Avengers were disappearing was when Black Panther disappeared. You know, like, no one even heard Okoye. Okoye is really gasped in the movie and was horrified, but no one even caught that, really. They just caught the tail end of it because the audience had the exact same reaction. And it was, it achieved a number of things. First of all, I think that it showed that these deaths weren't going to last, because you're like, there's no way you killed Black Panther, so none of this matters. And then also, I think it was embarrassing, because I think it showed that Marvel just had no idea, Disney Marvel had no idea in advance what they had in Black Panther. Like, are you really going to bench Black Panther for Avengers 4, right? Maybe all these characters who disappeared went to another realm, and so they can have a storyline there. Maybe they will now. Marvel's like, oh, they already filmed it, actually. So it's crazy. Yeah, they already filmed Avengers 4. Maybe this is sometimes why you don't want to film your movies back to back before you find out how some other ones might perform. And so it was just, I think, I wonder if people are going to pick up on that. That, you know, because how horribly the Black Panther and his supporting cast are undercut here. I think it really reveals, again, that Disney Marvel just simply did not know. They did not know! And there's another, well, I'll just mention it here. The other byproduct of that is that in an effort to appease those newly minted fans from the Black Panther movie, they pretty much showed all of this, that stuff in the advertisements. So, but when you get to the movie, there's nothing more to see. So that's kind of like a false advertising, a false promise. So it's crazy. Also, I want to point out that when Black Panther disappeared, and we were waiting for the end credits, if there was an end credit scene, and so all of us, they take your phone. So everybody stood near the doors because they wanted to get to the phone line as fast as possible. Because if you don't get there right away, I'm so proud of myself. I was like the third or fourth one there. Because actually, they moved the table and I spotted it. You know, everybody went left when they should have gone right. But anyway, so we were all standing there at the door being like, come on, come on, come on. And there's one guy, Black Panther has won over a lot of fans of color, but this, I think it's important to note, this was a white guy, and he just was like so angry and pacing, and he's like, no way Black Panther was killed. No way, it's so stupid. No way it's gonna happen. And I was like, calm down, buddy. And in fact, I even spoke up and said, yeah, there's no way he's dead. And then the guy was like, wow, what? Don't get into my personal space. I'm having a personal rant here. It was really funny. It was crazy. So it just goes to show you that the Black Panther being included in the characters that disappeared just cemented it for every single person in the audience that none of this matters. None of it's going to stick, right? I did feel a sheer sense of terror, though, as everyone started to disappear. But it wasn't because I was scared for everyone. I just didn't want my favorites to disappear. I kept looking at Tony and be like, oh, don't take Tony. Don't take Tony away. Please keep Tony. And he was fine. I wish his agent should have tapped me on the shoulder and been like, don't worry about it. Okay. So I said in my non-spoiler review that this was an incredibly interactive crowd, right? Not only did they gasp, though, but they also cheered. And I was surprised at who they cheered for. They cheered for Tony. They cheered for Cap. Huge cheers for Cap. Like when he emerged from the shadows in that train station, like it was like, I don't know, it was like President Obama or something. Like it was crazy. It was like an amazing, I've never seen anyone react that way for maybe like someone like Luke Skywalker, right? Like that kind of iconic character. It was nuts, right? And then they had like hardly anything for him to do in the movie. Crazy! And then also for Thor. Thor got a lot of claps too, at the very beginning. That was very nice. So it really was still the Trinity. Audiences still really liked the Trinity, which I am again baffled by, right? And I also, you know, they've all been going around saying, oh, my contract's up. Robert Downey Jr. is like, I think maybe I'm going to retire and go be Dr. Doolittle, right? And everyone's like, I can't believe what I'm hearing. Chris Evans is like, you know, I think it's time for me to be done. And then Chris Hemsworth's like, I don't have any movies left in my contract. You know what I think? I think they all just were doing a misdirect. I think they were just, you know, really honorably in the service of the film, trying to like get everybody to feel something was going to happen. And I'm curious why that hasn't, I don't know if was that good or bad. I think in the absence of anything like actually happening that was like really huge, I don't know how I feel about the teases, but they got us. They got me. So good for them. So they're not only beloved characters on screen, but beloved members of the MCU behind the scenes as well. They really are team players. Now, as for gasps, the biggest one, and I think probably because I participated in this one quite so, was when Tony got stabbed by Thanos with his own armor, right? Like, talk about adding insult to injury. But wow, everybody in the audience, I think, was like, this is it. Because, you know, Cap had just gotten knocked unconscious, I think, at that point. No, I don't think Thanos, I don't think he showed up. I'm not sure. But, you know, people thought, okay, is it Tony or Steve? And everybody, when that happened, when Tony got stabbed was like, okay, it's Tony. Oh my God, it's happening. We're witnessing cinematic history. And then it didn't happen. But at that moment, we all thought it was going to happen. So it was still a very pure reaction. Then craziest spoiler by far and away was when, again, Red Skull showed up as the Soul Stone Guardian. Everyone in the audience was like, what? And I had three thoughts. All right. So my first was, is Hugo Weaving back in the MCU fold, right? Like, remember he's like, I don't want to make this movie anymore. This was stupid. I regret even the one that I made. And suddenly, Cap loses his biggest villain, right? Although I think anyone could go under the makeup, right? I don't know. And I think it was Hugo Weaving. I forgot to check the credits. Maybe they didn't give him a credit. But you know what? I guess even if it wasn't Hugo Weaving, well, Kevin Feige just proved that Hugo Weaving is replaceable. So that was my first thought. My second thought was, that is a dope smoke cape. It was amazing. And not only was it very well realized, but it was unusually dark and creative for a Marvel movie. I was like, damn, that is sweet. And then my third thought was, Red Skull stole Dr. Doom's look, right? I mean, he looked so much like Dr. Doom. And Dr. Doom would totally guard the Soul Stone, by the way. And also, Red Skull would not. I mean, I know at the end of Captain America, the first Avenger, he disappeared into the Tesseract, which of course is another of the Infinity Stones. So I guess it took him to like another stone to protect. I don't know. It didn't make any sense. I think it was just, you know, they wanted a cool character to be revealed at that moment. And I have to admit, Red Skull was a pretty freaking awesome choice to put there. But it's also funny because clearly Marvel didn't know the Fox deal was in the cards when they made that decision to give him Dr. Doom's look. So they kind of cannibalized a character that they're probably about to get, which was hilarious to me. Again, it was a Red Skull Dr. Doom hybrid, basically. And I was into it. I liked it. Although, to be honest with you, I would have preferred if it had just been Dr. Doom. And so, you know, my head said Red Skull, but my heart said Dr. Doom. All right, so as for the Soul Stone, lame. I'm not going to let Marvel go on this one. I think that we all had better theories. There were so many good theories out there as to where this stupid thing was, and they went with this. And yes, someone did have to die to unlock the Soul Stone, as many of us had guessed, but it's not like the Soul Stone was Gamora's actual soul. That would have been so much cooler. And I think given a better, I also feel she's probably going to, will she be resurrected? I don't know. Maybe she's going to go make a bunch of Avatar movies. Maybe. So she's like, I'm busy. My dance card's full. So they're like, all right, peace out. We'll give you a great death scene. And I'm like, they did not, Zoe Saldana. But anyway, if it had been her soul in the gauntlet, maybe then they'd be like, okay, that gives us a feeling that maybe we can bring her back with the other five stones, right? But I think it was a wasted opportunity for something to add to the mythology, where a character sacrificed themselves or was killed on the battlefield that, you know, wasn't fridged, and that soul, then we saw that soul leave their body and go to the gauntlet. That would have been great. And I'm just a little frustrated that Marvel didn't take that opportunity. You know, from a mythology standpoint, from a visual standpoint, it's just lame. I didn't like what they did with the Soul Stone at all. All right, so then next up, as I said in my non-spoiler review, the Avengers need a no dating at work policy because it was a problem in this movie. It really annoyed me that they would have defeated Thanos. The glove was coming off. Did you see that? Spider-Man had it. If Peter Quill, and they were warning him, they were like, Peter Quill, don't keep with this line of questioning, don't you do it. And he kept, and Quill did it. I thought, you know, I mean, I can understand where Quill was coming from, obviously. You know, he and Gamora had finally had their I love you moment, right? Scarlet Witch and Vision were also going to have one though, which I think takes away from, you know, a little bit from both of them. I just thought it was cheap. I didn't like it. Also because I don't really buy the Gamora Peter Quill relationship, you know? I don't know. So I was frustrated because the plan, and also because Gamora had said we have to save the whole universe. I mean, like, there would have been time to ask Thanos once the glove was off. Once the gloves are off, right, Peter Quill? I mean, just think for a minute, damn it. So that was frustrating to me. And then I also thought it was very weird. I don't know why nobody else picked up on this when they were making the movie. They were like, why are we putting both couples in the exact same situation where one has to kill the other? And they didn't even comment on that or make them mirror each other that much, right? It wasn't like, oh, one couple does one thing, one does another. Because, you know, Peter Quill invented... Oh, by the way, who else thought it was hilarious that Thanos kept turning everything into bubbles, right? I was like, that's actually kind of cute. Like, anything he could think of in the world. And he's like, I'm partial to bubbles. I'm like, we're all partial to bubbles, Thanos. But I didn't think you were that kind of crowd pleaser. It just goes to show he truly does have a soft side. Because he turned things into bubbles twice. I thought that was hilarious. Also, I really like Thanos. Speaking of Peter Quill and Gamora, When Thanos disappeared after he took Gamora and he said, "I like you," to Peter Quill, part of me was like, "Oh, you're in, Peter!" Like, I felt kind of happy for Peter. I was like, "Oh, you've earned Thanos' favor." I feel all warm and cuddly. So I could see also why Gamora was torn about him, too. He was like, he's very charismatic. I mean, he's kind of cool. I mean, he's evil, obviously, but I see the coolness to him. And he likes bubbles. He's got a heart. It was hilarious. I think they could have had the situation, I think a more sophisticated script, or even just a good script, like a quality script that understands the importance of screenwriting, would have realized that if you're going to have two couples in the exact same situation, they have to serve as commentaries on each other. It's screenwriting, not 101 maybe, but certainly 201, okay? But however, I have to say, I kind of love that Scarlet Witch didn't hesitate as much when she had to kill Vision, right? Just like in Civil War, she was like, "Don't pull your punches, Hawkeye. I'll hit Iron Man with actual cars." I like that there's a villain deep down in there somewhere, and they better not be just teasing me. They better eventually bring it out. I thought that was great. Now, as for Thanos, great work by Josh Brolin. Really, you know, that charisma we just talked about was all him. And his voice work, you know, usually you think, you know, like, oh, that purple thing just has Josh Brolin's voice. But he just created a full character, in my opinion. But I did think it was weird that at the end of the day, it was all just about population control, which I'd like to point out he was already doing. He was just looking for an easier, more efficient way with less resistance, right? He's like, I want to bring down my costs, so I'm going to go and get this Infinity Gauntlet. And then I can just snap my fingers, and do what I want. And I hope that when we pick up on the next Avengers movie, we do see the utopia, obviously at a price, though, that Thanos promised, that Gamora's home planet got. You know, when he was bragging, he's like, it's a paradise. And she's like, half the people are dead. And he's like, but everybody who's left is having a great time. So it would be interesting if maybe the world, Earth, has flourished after Thanos snapped his fingers. And you know, there are just some people like the Avengers who are like, it was wrong, you know, what we did. You know, I don't think the price was worth it. Like, a lot of talk about price in here, or at least there should be. You know, there should be more of it. Again, screenwriting 201 would have taken care of that. All right, so as for the gauntlet, the Infinity Gauntlet, and the stones, I thought they were pretty well utilized, although he never threw an actual moon. Again, I thought that was a bit of a cop-out. He just threw pieces of a moon. If I had been on the ground, I would not have been able to resist taunting Thanos. I'd be like, oh, so only crumble. Is that it, huh? If I had that gauntlet, I could have pulled the whole damn thing down. All right, so my favorite thing, though, and I was surprised how the reality stone was used. It was really, you know, I thought it could actually alter reality, not just put on like a trick show or a misdirect, right? A sleight of hand. But it was well used, I think, several times in the movie. And I thought the most interesting thing was that Benicio del Toro showed up just to do, for a hot minute, no less, his zany Charlie Chaplin impression. And I have to say, it made an impression. I was like, oh, that was good. When he waved goodbye, I was like, oh, I had fun seeing you, Benicio. When are you and Jeff Goldblum going to do a scene together? Although apparently now he's dead, so I guess not, unless they use time travel to the way they change all this stuff. Although I don't know if they're going to. All right, so then the Black Order. We'll talk about Ebony Maw when I talk about the team storylines, but I just want to talk about them overall. And I will say, as I'm sure many of you will as well, they were surprisingly disposable. But I think that was the point. It's like when you fight robots. You're like, go to town. These guys are super bad, so you don't have to pull your punches. And I thought the CGI in them, though, was also very good. I thought they did, you know, I thought they looked pretty good. You know, they didn't look perfect, but they looked believable. And I don't think I ever once was snapped out of the reality of the movie. I was like, oh, cool, all right. Although none of them, you know, there are four of them, and Ebony Maw was by far and away the best. I mean, you couldn't even tell that Proxima Midnight and Corius Glaive were married, which I was like, what? That's like, how could you not touch on that? And it was annoying. But here's another time that I want to point out an unfairness. When Batman kills people, everybody loses their mind. But when the Avengers kill people, like a lot of people, and unapologetically even, like Black Widow was like, we don't want to kill you, but we will. And I was like, that's not very believable, Black Widow. I think you do want to kill them, okay? Everyone's fine with it. Everyone's like, yeah, go ahead, kill everybody, it's all right. And I'm like, what? Again, I feel like I'm taking crazy pills. You have to be consistent in your criticism. And some people might, I'm sure some of you will be like, oh, well, it's different with Marvel, yada, yada, yada. It's not. In fact, even less so, because Marvel's supposed to be bright and cheery and family friendly, and then they go and kill a bunch of people, and you know, everyone's like, oh, yeah, you know, that's fine. But when Batman did it again in a very dark adult film, I was disgusted. Come on. All right, so now I want to go into the individuals in another video, the individual Avengers. Here I'm going to talk about it in teams, you know, the storylines. But I would like to take a second to mention how disappointing Mark Ruffalo's Hulk was. He did have one good line, though. They could have given it to someone else, but I did love his, because, you know, he had to catch up on everything that he missed while he was away in Thor Ragnarok. And I loved it when he said, there's an Ant-Man and a Spider-Man. You were like, oh, that is hilarious. And that does make a lot of sense. That would confuse you. I thought that was a great joke. But otherwise, what a total waste. I think Bruce Banner has become a caricature of what he was when he started out. I think that he's lost his bearing as to what of the line. Remember he said, I'm always angry? I don't think he's ever angry anymore. I think he's, in fact, one of the most chill people I've ever met, you know, in these movies. So that's frustrating. And then Hulk wouldn't come out and kept saying, like, no. And by the way, I'm glad that Mark Ruffalo clarified that because I had no idea what he was saying. But I was like, you can't just say no with no explanation or even a hint of an explanation. What the heck, man? And I also would like to say at the very end when everyone was like, oh, everyone's faded away and died or a bunch of people have died and there were only a couple Avengers left. Who else thought that Mark Ruffalo in the Hulkbuster suit looked so bad on the VFX? I mean, he literally looked like he was just floating, like just his head and shoulders were floating in the upper corner of the screen. And there were some VFX that had sloppily been put in around him. That was surprising. That was bad VFX. I was really surprised at that. All right, so let's talk about the teams. And they happen to be in the order of my favorite. So first off, Iron Man, Doctor Strange, Spider-Man, and one half of the Guardians. Peter Quill, Drax, Mantis, and Nebula. How could they resist not having the facial hair bros line from the comics? There's no shame in taking a fantastic instant classic line from the comics. And how could they not look at each other and be like, this, or no one else comment on the fact that they look so much alike, right? The styling is so similar. I thought they made Doctor Strange a little bit too much of a pompous jerk here. I wasn't quite sure why. I mean, I know that's kind of the character, but I thought it wasn't quite working for me. You know, I was like, dude, chill. Now, also, the other thing that surprised me here was that with Chris Pratt, they actually called him on his weight gain. Chris Pratt, of course, is famous for not only having a wonderful sense of humor and personality, but of course for having an amazing physical transformation thanks to the film Zero Dark Thirty. And he has, you know, not been able to maintain it, it seems. And so for the movie to actually, though, make jokes about that for like a couple of minutes, I was surprised. And I wonder how Chris Pratt felt about that. That took me out of the movie just for a second because I was like, yeah, wow, I can't believe that you're doing this in the movie. I mean, it was a little bit weird. But also, you know, and also I have to say, you know, on a side note, he always used to blame his ex-wife for making him heavy, saying she fed him too much. And, you know, I don't know. I didn't like the dynamics of that too much. And although I feel bad that maybe he's sad about what's going on in his personal life. And that's why, I don't know. Again, as I said, it took me out of the movie for just a moment. But this, as I said, was my favorite group and my favorite storyline. I absolutely loved it. And I thought Ebony Maw was great at the beginning of this for this team. I thought Ebony Maw was a fabulous villain. They changed his powers. He's just basically a telekinetic. But I was okay with it because he was an amazing telekinetic. And you know who he was totally channeling? Magneto. He was so Magneto-y, and I loved every second of it. Great. And I thought that, you know, that Irish actor did a great job with the voice work. Although, again, I was like, he speaks Earth English. And he, you know, they didn't even, like, reverberate his voice or anything. I thought that was a little odd. But then, you know what else was weird? That he was killed so easily. I mean, it was hilarious that they, you know, Peter referenced another old movie, this time Aliens. Although, I was like, that's quite a stretch. You know, when he did the Star Wars reference, I immediately got what the plan was. But I being familiar with Aliens, was like, I'm still not quite sure where you're going with this plan. But anyway, they sucked Ebony Maw into space, and he died. I was surprised that he died. I mean, this is a guy who works in space, and has worked in space for quite some time. How has this never come up before? I mean, I guess in Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2, they were sucking people out into space and killing them with the, you know, with the Yondu's, you know, I think they're, I forgot the name, I think they're the Marauders or something, I don't know. Sorry, I forgot. So I guess it happens, but yeah, I don't know. Ebony Maw was supposed to be so badass. I was just really surprised that he was, like, killed, like, in the first third of the movie. But, you know, it was fine. I had a great time while he was on screen. Loved him. And then, you know what my favorite moments was with this team? It was just a quiet moment, but when they were having their little powwow about what to do when they were on Titan waiting for Thanos to show up, and Tony Stark says, Mr. Lorre, could you bring your team in for the huddle, right? I loved it because it was two team leaders talking to each other. It was respect of the other team leader and, you know, his group, you know. It just reminded me so much of, like, two regular teams working together. I just really liked it. It was just one of my favorite little moments in the movie. I just thought it was great. And I also liked when Doctor Strange was figuring out like all the different outcomes using the time stone. I thought that was really cool when he was like, I've seen like over like, I don't know, like 14 million or some huge number of outcomes. I knew he was going to say like just one worked, but it was still cool when he did it. I thought that was great. And then you know who else I have to give a major shout out to? Mantis, who was surprisingly effective with this group. I thought she turned out to be a real asset to the team, any team. And so she was great. I liked having her in the movie a lot. I think she was a great addition to the Guardians of the Galaxy and therefore also a great addition to this Avengers film. All right, so that's the first team. The second team, Thor, Rocket Raccoon, and Groot. Second favorite. Absolutely adored them. Favorite Thor lines. Still so funny. I've made friends with the tree. That was fantastic. Also when he turned to Cap and he said, I see you've copied my beard. I just thought it was hilarious. It was really great. But then he was able to flip it around and give that really touching speech about how everyone he knows is dead. I thought that was great. I also loved it when he came up to Gamora and he was like, I too know your pain, family pain. You know, talking about his sister, you know, Hela. I thought that was just really fun. And also that Chris Pratt was like, take a step back, buddy. That everything Thor did was great. Thor is just now such a fabulous character thanks to Thor Ragnarok. He's just a joy to watch. Not only when he's cracking jokes, but also when he's using his lightning powers. I loved it. When he let loose at the end of the movie, when he finally had Stormbreaker, that was just phenomenal. I loved with the lightning, watching him hop around. It was just really spectacular. He is just such a great character. He can't go. I need more Thor movies. Now, speaking of forging Stormbreaker, that was okay. It was something for this trio to do, and I would have been happy, again, watching them do anything. I would love to see them shop for groceries. And there's an idea. We all love the Thor, like, regular life Thor shorts that they made to promote Thor Ragnarok. I say keep going, but now with his tree and rabbit. And also, I saw some people say that the rabbit joke got old. Never got old to me. I was enjoying it the whole time. I thought it was great. But you know who I didn't like? Peter Dinklage, too on the nose. And when he showed up, my audience laughed, and not like in a good way, like in a, oh, you jumped the shark kind of way. It was just too silly. I think Peter Dinklage is just too well-defined at this point. And then he was a giant dwarf, which, you know, you're like, that doesn't really make any sense. I wasn't feeling it. And, you know, I don't even know why he was needed. They could have just had, like, a recipe book left. And also, I thought it was crazy that Peter Dinklage's character was like, I thought if I did what Thanos wanted, he would spare everyone's life. And I was like, when does that happen? Although he did keep his agreement with Doctor Strange over sparing Iron Man's life, but I guess at that point he had what, I don't know, Thanos was a real mercurial dude, but I guess that's part of his charm. Okay. All right, so then the final team, Cap, Black Widow, Falcon, Bucky, Vision, Wanda, and then Black Panther and friends. Too big a team. There's the problem right there. And most of their stuff was shown in the advertising. Again, I think because everybody loves Cap and Black Panther right now, Marvel was like, well, what Cap and Black Panther footage do we have? And they're like, but that's all of it. And they're like, who cares? We need people to come and see this movie. So I'm curious for those of you who are Cap and Black Panther fans, how did you feel with how little time they had in the film? I mean, so little time was given to them, they never even bothered to put in a line, even just a single line to explain why Black Widow dyed her hair blonde. I was like, you guys don't seem like you're in hiding. So I don't know why she changed her hair. I think it's weird. And then I felt really bad for Okoye because her Starbucks line and the Olympics line was given away in the advertising, so it didn't hit at the screening because we'd already heard it. But thankfully, she had a follow-up great line where when Scarlet Witch finally let loose, she was like, why is she hopping down in the field the whole time? That was a great reaction. And you know what else made me feel nice about Danai Gurira and her character? And that at the beginning of the movie, they added her to one of the letters in Marvel Studios. She caught my eye right away because she was so fierce. And I was just really happy for her and for her fans. I just love that character. And so at least she got that. At least she got that. And she's still alive at the end of the movie. So maybe they've already filmed it, but hopefully they had the foresight to give her a lot of stuff to do in Avengers 4. Now, as for the end credits, yes, there was a Captain Marvel shout out. That'll be getting its own video, and we will talk about that there. So that's my Avengers Infinity War spoiler review. I hope you had fun talking about it with me and you enjoyed your meal or multiple snacks if that's the route you decided to go. You might have just come from the movie and be full on your popcorn. But lots more Avengers Infinity War coverage is coming now that the movie is opened and we can talk spoilers. All right, and you can check out some more of those videos right now.